Partly cloudy Monday and Tuesday next week, with temperatures staying in the low 20s. More news as it happens on 5AA.
1395, Adelaide's 5AA. This is Peter Godfrey.
Seven past five. Temperature, we're on almost 16 degrees at the moment. Been a bit of a damp night too, drizzling pretty much right through, but I think we've got some sunshine coming tomorrow, which would be nice. Let's take a look at what's happening across the ditch, though, in New Zealand. Editor of eveningreport.nz, Sewell Manning with us this morning. Hey, Sewell, how are you?
Yeah, very good, Peter. Over here, similar temperatures. We're sitting here with an overnight low of 16 degrees, heading for a high in Auckland City of 21 degrees, and it's heavy overcast at the moment, raining right through the night, really, and we're expecting a bit of a storm coming up. If you look at the front page of the online edition of the New Zealand Herald, we've got to go way down. It actually looks like it's disappeared, but it did have it there that you can expect 140-kilometre winds coming through at some stage. Oh, there it is. Yeah, prepare for 140-kilometre winds with heavy rain. We've certainly had the heavy rain already, so a bit of a storm coming in.
Oh.
But it's leading, Peter. How do you like this for a front page of the major newspaper in New Zealand, or the front of the website anyway? Every rose has a thorn. Why did the bachelor dump his love? Now, that's leading the New Zealand Herald. If you look for some respite from that kind of thing and you go across to Fairfax's Stuff website, and that's leading, who saw it coming? And then there were none. The romance lasted for 72 hours. The bachelor, blah, blah, blah. Kiwis fixated. Go down page a bit, and we've got 4.7 earthquake hit Wellington overnight around Masterton. Had a pretty strong there. Also, Bay of Plenty was shaken with a similar kind of earthquake only this morning as well, but got a hunt for that. So the bachelor is the big news, Peter.
Forget the earthquakes, forget 140-kilometre-hour winds. Bachelor is more important. There you go.
Good.
Good to have your priorities. Well, is the bachelor taking more prominence than your prime minister and what happened in Parliament with him yesterday?
Well, yes, yeah, no, Prime Minister John Key. Peter, he was chucked out of Parliament yesterday, first time in my memory anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And that was after a series of questions were probing into what his government was going to be doing about New Zealand's foreign trust tax haven debacle. Now, the background to this, Peter, is New Zealand was named in the Panama Papers, you know, the major leak relating to these trusts that's really taken the world by surprise in some ways. New Zealand was named in these Panama Papers as a tax haven alongside 20 other countries. People can't see it, but I sent you through a graphic on that showed all the countries. Australia isn't listed, by the way, so good on you people for that. But New Zealand was among others in this region alongside the Cook Islands, which is notorious for its tax haven status. Niue, which is a bit of a surprise here, Samoa, Singapore, of course, and Hong Kong. Now, this week, a joint investigation, Peter, launched its findings. That joint investigation was between Television New Zealand, Radio New Zealand, and internationally regarded investigative journalist Nikki Hager. Now, they revealed that New Zealand was referenced more than 61,000 times in the latest release of documents. And that's information, once again, that was leaked from the Panamanian company Mossack Fonseca. Now, that company, just very quickly, specialises in foreign trust and taxation services. And in the last 2 years, Peter, that company has actively promoted New Zealand to its clients, particularly those from Latin America, as a place where you can park their money and their wealth and keep it very, very secure. Now, since then, there's been a spike in money flowing into the foreign trust held in New Zealand here, and also look-through companies. Those are the ones that will have, you know, a New Zealander as a director, basically, but you can't see anything beyond that. That's what's going through there. When John Key became Prime Minister, and this is a significant point politically here, that was way back in 2008 when he won that election against Helen Clark. And on numerous occasions since then, he's openly spoken about his desire to see New Zealand become the Switzerland of the South Pacific or the Singapore of Australasia. In essence, when you boil that down, what he was talking about was a place where foreign currencies, wealth, goods, services, transactions could be traded and transacted fairly freely. And in a first world security kind of environment that New Zealand offers, And when it comes to foreign trusts, with a minimum of public disclosure and a high degree of confidentiality wrapped around those, Peter.
So in other words, people with some dirty money can hide it there in New Zealand and clean it up. That's what comes down to essentially, is it?
That's where the possibilities are, okay. And this is where the investigations are leading when there's some fairly unsavoury characters that have been certainly doing this. Now, just in the public opinion stakes, this poll I'm going to reference here, Peter, goes back 2 weeks. And since then, the Panama Papers, they were released in the first wave of it back in April, of course. There was a poll done by UMR at that stage, and it found 57% of those polled here in New Zealand were concerned that New Zealand was harbouring foreign trusts here and that they were being used by people for tax evasion purposes. And only 21% thought that John Key's government was handling the tax haven problem well. So they're really losing the ground on this politically, but that's only one side of it, of course. 52% believed a full independent inquiry was needed, and women in particular were upset, with 63% of women polled concerned that New Zealand was being used as a tax haven in this manner. Now, since then, it's been fairly bad news for the Prime Minister, and his initial attempts were, and instinctually was, to try and shut down the problem, give themselves some time. But last week, the Kiwis found out more about this and found that Inland Revenue here, our department, it had sought a review some time ago on how these foreign trusts were being set up and operated since John Key's government changed the law back in 2011. Now, it was a strange kind of exchange, Peter. I'll just touch on the main points here. But the Prime Minister's lawyer that handles trusts for the Prime Minister's personal wealth himself. Now, this guy met with John Key, the Prime Minister, and he said, I'm a bit concerned that the government's going to make a move on clamping down on the foreign trust. Now, John Key says he replied, "I don't know anything about that. Go and talk to the Revenue Minister," a guy at that time was Todd McClay. Now, then, so the Prime Minister's lawyer gets an appointment with this particular Minister of Revenue the next day, which it takes months for anybody of high position to get it, let alone a mate of another politician. So things have certainly moved to accommodate that. The lawyer took in a posse of others, that accountants and lawyers that operate foreign trusts, and they get in there and they tell this Revenue Minister that his boss, the Prime Minister, said he doesn't want any changes made to the law in this way at all. So the consequence of that meeting was that the Revenue Minister got on the blower or instructed his officials at Inland Revenue and says, "We're not going to have any review of Inland Revenue relating to the foreign trust here. We want it to be left alone. It's not a high priority." So that absolutely blew up around John Key. Yeah. They were forced into a position where a review, Peter, was called. Now, all of this goes back to how all of this works, and a lot of people probably are aware of it, but the big thing is here is that money coming in, if we just look at the tax evasion kind of area, Peter, very quickly, money comes in to New Zealand into a foreign trust. The way it's set up, no one really knows where the money came from, how it was earned, who the people or the principals behind that are. But it gets here, and because it's a foreign trust, the changes to the law that the Nationals did when John Key, since he's been Prime Minister, is that it's taxed at 0%. So it's 0% tax, but the people who administer the trust are able to send it back to the country where the money came from, saying it's been taxed in New Zealand. Just by the loophole being that it's been taxed at 0% is immaterial. Mm. So people putting their money into New Zealand for that way, they hide it around here, keep it away from the wife or whoever or whatever, and they get zero tax certificate on that, meaning it's paid its tax, meaning it hasn't paid anything, but it's registered as having done so. So therefore, it's excluded from being paid tax back in its original country. Now, that's the more savoury elements of it. Of course, these kind of things attract all sorts of dodgy practice, yeah. Peter, and that's where other main concerns are. Was there drug deals? Because the big money that's been flowing in has been coming from countries that are notorious in that space, like Mexico, Colombia, and other Latin American countries. The individuals involved in those, and is there also gun-running money that is going through, and also ultimately has New Zealand exposed itself to harbouring money of which terrorists dip into from time to time?
That's a pretty hot potato to be floating around. So John Key's he's defending this basically, so he doesn't see a problem with it.
Well, he's got a review going. He's backed down. He's flip flopped, if you want to call it that way, on that, and he says, "Yep, we'll have a review." And now his position this week has softened to a degree, and he says whatever the recommendations coming back on that tax haven review, the government will be sympathetic to those recommendations.
He's
trying to say, you know, we're looking seriously at this, and he actually said that we're looking seriously at this. But he refuses to have a commission of inquiry, an independent inquiry into the whole deal, and people are, you know, you've got to say, the public, you hear people talking about this everywhere. They're saying, we don't like this. So the glorious John Key, which has been much loved in this country and probably will remain so, there's a sizable proportion of the population saying, you know, we don't want to be a part of anything that could be a dodgy practice. We don't want New Zealand to be the ticket clicker for money that's just flowing in and flowing out so people overseas can at best avoid paying their tax.
Mm. So back to where we started, so with him being tossed out of Parliament, so he was getting questioned heavily on this and didn't like it.
He didn't like it. Out of Parliament. Back to where we started on this one, Peter. Yesterday in the House, he was being asked a series of questions on this. He was very, very animated, got stuck into the opposition. He was on such a roll that when the Speaker stood to bring order back into the Parliament, the Prime Minister ignored him, wouldn't sit down, keep pointing and shouting and carry on. You know how they carry on, politicians, sometimes in Parliament. Went on and on and on, and the Speaker had a gutsful, basically, to put it simply, and said, right, sit down. And, well, the Prime Minister at that stage was starting to sit down. He says, you can basically get out of the chamber. He says, you can leave the chamber. First time I've even noticed that. I can't remember Helen Clark, David Longy or Jim Bolger or any of those Prime Ministers being chucked out of their Parliament. John Key's certainly showing that he's, there's two things that show, Peter, and it's one, he's getting irrational in his responses when he's in that environment, and secondly, it appears that his moral compass is not in alignment with what other Kiwis are.
It's getting a little bit wobbly, that compass, by the sound of it.
Bit wobbly.
Hey, while we're on politics, just interested in just your perspective on a problem we've got here at the moment. We've been having, well, it seems like an epidemic of water main failures and bursts with leaks, and some just small, some much larger, causing a lot of damage in homes being flooded and so on. We had a huge one in the city yesterday with a water spurt from this main right in the centre of the city, 20 to 30 metres high, the water shooting out from it.
It's higher than a Rotorua geyser.
Well, David,
you wouldn't want to be sitting on top like some sort of cartoon thing, with the geyser going up.
Well, actually, on breakfast yesterday, David and Will were hit on the idea of it could become, a bit like Old Faithful, that geyser, that could become a tourist attraction for Adelaide. But
you don't have to go to Yellowstone National Park to see it. You don't have to trek across to New Zealand to Rotorua to see the geysers and the thermal activity. You've got it there.
Exactly.
Might be man-made through folly or whatever. But no, Peter, I gave this a bit of thought, and I honestly don't believe that the main mains and the big water supply pipes are a problem here in New Zealand. It's not popping up in that way. There are buildings that have suffered bursts. You mentioned to me, I wasn't aware of it, but the Auckland Library, you told me off air, had a burst there. I know that Wellington, the new public hospital down there, has had, all new fitted out, of course, about 4 years ago, and the copper piping in there is presenting as porous and are getting bursts. Mm. I think, unfortunately, there was an Australian company that handled that, but the copper was sourced from further afield.
Sorry.
And the New Zealand builders are kind of getting whacked around with it as well. So, there's that kind of thing. And residential housing, houses that have been fitted out in the 90s are bursting, and people are, the insurance companies are getting claims for that. I'm aware of that, but not the big mains like what you're talking about.
Okay. Yeah. And I was just curious, particularly for Auckland, given, there's certain similarities between our two cities and, similar population and size and all that kind of thing. So I wondered whether, because our water authorities are saying, we're doing better than our interstate counterparts, that we have less bursts on our main water lines than they do. So just curious about your situation. But
I wonder if it's the heat.
Don't know. I mean, we do have a problem with our soil is quite movable at times in some areas, but, I guess that could be a factor, but a lot of the concerns are raised that there's just not enough maintenance being done in the past and presently on water mains. So, yeah. And we're getting, you know, a week doesn't go by with a burst to varying degrees, but a spectacular one yesterday. Mm.
Yeah. Well, you know, this earthquake has hit Bay of Plenty just, you know, a couple of hours, 3 hours, 2.5 hours south of Auckland.
Yeah.
5.2 quake this morning through the early hours of the morning. No reports of water mains breaking.
Okay, so, okay.
There you go.
Hate to think what would happen if we had a bit of a rumble. Thankfully, we don't get them too often, but, yeah, who knows, who knows. We had to press on before we get short of time. Hey, I've been curiously noticing just recently your police force has been garnering a lot of attention. A little challenge that they threw down, what is it, a running man challenge. A little bit of a dance to a bit of music and challenging other police forces around the world to try to replicate, which has been happening, including our South Australian police. What's the reaction in New Zealand? Is this a big PR thing for New Zealand police or what?
It's a big PR thing.
Yeah.
To be awfully honest about this, Peter, because we're confronted with front page news items about The Bachelor, you know, I get to the point where I roll my eyes at this kind of thing. has the reverse effect on me, although obviously it doesn't on everybody, but I've become old and cynical and cranky, I think.
I thought you had your cynical hat on for this one.
You know, I kind of look at it and I kind of think, Peter, yeah, I can see what you're doing. You're trying to get more recruits and you're trying to get recruits that think it's going to be cool doing dances around, you know, the suburbs when you're out on the beat. The problem is the cops hate going on the beat in this country.
Okay.
You know, to get the cops out on walking the beat is like pulling teeth. They'll go to their union and moan, you know, if they have to do that type of thing. So I kind of look at it very cynically about this dance thing. And, they're probably all actors for a start. I know that the fire service started to pick up on the challenge and didn't want to miss out on it.
Yeah.
Recruit, so it got in on it. You kind of imagine the outcry if it was the corrections department screws doing this, you know. But then again, in New Zealand, you know, the Serco staff, that's the private company that runs most of the prisons here. It's staff kind of, you know, were caught on video having, well, you know, staged fights with the inmates. So, and that went viral. Mm-hmm. You know, you can go on. You know, sorry, Peter, you can see I'm getting old and cranky about this kind of stuff. But yes, publicity stunt.
Publicity stunt. Okay. Was it kind of just a few of the officers that took it on themselves to do this, or was this sort of from within, do you know?
This is from within.
It is
from
within. Okay, so it's sort of
part of being cool. This would have been authorised by the Office of the Commissioner.
Yeah, okay.
But, yeah, no, it went big and, you know, they seem to do a pretty good job and, you know, I guess, you know, as I understand it, Peter, they're actors in it, but if I got that wrong, well, then, you know, they're obviously enjoying their day on the job.
Yeah.
And then other people that would join the cynicism would say, well, why aren't you out there doing the job yourself?
I guess it's another aspect of the internet that these things just travel everywhere. I mean, I don't know, there's a police force in the Western world that hasn't taken it up. And
Peter, you hit me on a day when, you know, the lead story in the New Zealand Herald and on the Fairfax ones was The Bachelor.
Yes, indeed.
and it's going to get worse, I've got to say. You know, most of us are dismayed because Fairfax and APN that owns the New Zealand Herald are talking now about merging into one. So New Zealand, that would be like all of your main newspaper labels all becoming one in Australia.
Okay. Well, they almost are, but not quite.
Mm. Yeah. So, you know, Duncan Garner, who's quite a personality over here, used to be, the political editor for TV3 and before that was certainly prominent in TV1 as well. And he put out overnight on Twitter, have these two companies merged already? You know, it seems like they've got the same stuff in the same places on their websites already. So, but yeah, it's slightly diverting away, Peter. But I guess we can see, you know, to be fair to the cops on this one, the dancing man or running man dance, it seems that they can pick up that there's a big traction for them in a positive way when they actually put such things out in social media and they go viral. But I thought the best thing that ever went viral, Peter, just in closing, was that wonderful thing with those Kiwi dogs driving the minis around the racetrack. you spotted that first, yes, and raised it online.
Oh, that was great. All right. Yeah, well, I'm guessing so, and you won't be putting that record on to do your own Running Man dance anytime soon, but... Neither will I, for that matter.
Yeah.
Have a great week, Selwyn. Thanks for joining us this morning, and we'll catch you again next week.
You too, Peter.
All the best. Bye-bye. Selwyn Manning, editor of eveningreport.nz. 28 past five, nearly. Ann Stone coming up shortly with all the latest 5AA news, sport and weather, and then more of your calls here at 5AA.
5AA Breakfast.
From Luke Beveridge, he's come out and given the Crows an almighty clip about questioning the umpires.
Any doubt around the integrity of an umpire's performance for me is disgusting.
Say what you like about Luke Beveridge, he is tactically smart because the Western Bulldogs are so far ahead in the free count, but why wouldn't you mount an impassioned defence of the standard of umpiring?
5AA Breakfast, weekday mornings from 6 on 1395, Adelaide's 5AA.
Hello, Frank Walker from National Tiles. With National Tiles' amazing under-tile heating, your floor tiles will be as warm as toast this winter. Whether you're building or renovating, insist on National Tiles' under-tile heating. And from less than $500 for an average bathroom floor, it's an excellent investment in your home's comfort. National Tiles Under Tile Heating. The best $500 investment in home comfort you'll ever make.
Like any great footy team, you need to build on a solid foundation. 25 years ago, the Adelaide Fresh Group did just that. They grew year on year by putting you first, offering a totally unique and rewarding buying experience. Today, they lead the way with their selection of cold meats, cheeses, gourmet continental goods, fresh flowers, and more. So call into Adelaide Fresh Morphett